Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, we're on the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to this special event, Voices of Color in Food, curated by Olaiya Land and presented in partnership with Book Larder. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. We have closed captioning for this event. You can access the closed captioning by clicking on the icon at the bottom of your Zoom screen. And after the panelists are done chatting, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your questions at any time during the program by writing them in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. So we'll have the chat open for chatting and sharing your own experiences and for applauding for the panelists. And then we have the Q&A box open for when you have questions that you'd like the panelists to answer. And then finally, after the program, we're interested in hearing from you. We'll post a link to a program survey in the chat toward the end of the event, and I'd appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill it out. We'd love to hear what you think. Now I'm delighted to introduce Meghna Gerardi from Book Larder, who will introduce tonight's speakers. Hey, Meghna.
Hi, Stesha. Thanks so much for having us.
Yeah.
Really excited to be a part of this event. Hello to everyone attending. My name is Meghna Gerardi. I am the event manager here at Book Larder. We are a cookbook store in the Fremont neighborhood, and we do a variety of cooking classes, in-store and virtual author talks and events. We sell cookbooks, of course, and have a very well-stocked selection of food writing. So happy to be a resource to anyone here in the community. Thanks so much for joining us. Today, I have the pleasure of introducing all of our panelists, but I'd like to begin with our moderator and host for the evening, Olaiya Land. Olaiya Land is the founder and editor of Lionesse, an online journal and community promoting connection, confidence, sisterhood, and self-love. She's the host of the Lionesse podcast and also leads retreats and workshops all over the world that help people feel empowered and connected to their creativity. We at Book Larder have had the pleasure of working with Olaiya in the past, and I'm very happy to see that she's been curating this selection of talks at the library. So really excited for this. For tonight's event, Olaiya will speak with sommelier Cha McCoy, restaurateur Musang Miranda, and cookbook author Tara O'Brady. With that, I'd like to bring Olaiya onto the screen. Thanks so much.
Thank
you. So excited to be here with you.
Hi. Thanks for the intro. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the talk. So I am Olaiya. And before we bring on our panelists this evening, I want to do something that I haven't been doing before these talks, which was to talk a little bit more about my background. Specifically, so I am the founder and editor of Lionesse, which is the online community and journal devoted to empowering women. I am also getting certified to be a pleasure and empowerment coach. Empowerment is very important to me, especially for women of color. But I wanted to talk a little bit about my culinary background, first of all, so it makes sense why I'm curating this talk. And also because part of my goal with this talk is to show people the different forms that careers in food can take. So I wanted to talk briefly about my own background. So I have worked in food pretty steadily since I was 14. I have worked in restaurants, front of the house, back of the house. I taught cooking classes for over a decade. I was the co-founder of a cooking school here in Seattle called The Pantry. I taught cooking classes at the beautiful Book Larder for many years. I had for 6 years a food and travel blog called Millie's Kitchen, named after my grandmother. And as part of that, I led culinary and creativity retreats primarily in Paris and Portugal. So that is a little bit about my path. And I'm so grateful for the library. First of all, the Seattle Public Library, I think, is one of the best library systems in the country. We have such a good library system. Books have been a lifesaver for me like my entire life, but especially during the pandemic. I've been so grateful for our library system. And I'm so grateful that we have a library that organizes and sponsors events like this. So happy to be collaborating with them. Really happy to be collaborating with Book Larder. If you don't know them, please go to their website, check them out. Amazing bookstore. We need to keep independent bookstores like Book Larder in business, and they just do wonderful stuff. So I wanted to call those out before we start. And also just to talk about part of the reason that this topic came to mind for me, both because I have a background in food, but also because food is inherent to me in the idea of community. And I feel like with the past couple years that we have had, we need community more than ever. And I feel like situating food in community is very important and something that is sometimes or often overlooked. So I really want to talk about the community element of food. Another goal of the talk is really to amplify voices of color. So to lay out some ways that we can use our privilege, whatever level of privilege we have, whether we're people of color or not, but to amplify voices in the world of food, to be good allies, and also to highlight, like I said, the various paths that a career in food can take. So all three of our panelists have very different backgrounds, different paths. My path is different. So I think it's important to have representation, like in all fields, but especially in the food field where people of color are underrepresented at the higher levels. So just wanted to talk a little bit about the idea behind the talk, the goals for the talk, my path before we get started. And with all of that, Magna, do you want to introduce our speakers?
Yes, I'm so excited to hear all of our panelists speak to their experiences. Today we have joining us Tara O'Brady. Tara O'Brady is the author of the best-selling cookbook, Seven Spoons, which we do have stocked here at Book Larder.
So good.
And the award-winning site of the same name. The cookbook garnered mention in the New York Times, Flair, Canadian House and Home, and others. Tara is a contributor to The Globe and Mail and Up Curious. Her work has been featured in numerous publications, including The Guardian, Kinfolk, Olive Magazine, and on Oprah.com, JamieOliver.com, Bon Appetit, Savoir, and The Splendid Table. She is the culinary host for The Globe's and Mail's travel program, a regular expert on various national television broadcasts, and cultural consultant for the new CBC series, Run the Verbs. Also joining us today is Melissa Miranda. Melissa is the chef and owner of Musang, a Filipinx restaurant that opened in Seattle's Beacon Hill neighborhood in January 2020. She attended culinary school and worked in kitchens in Florence, Italy, before cooking for 2 years in New York City. After returning to Seattle, she worked as a sous chef at Bar del Corso while developing Musang. At Musang, she works with her team to craft dishes inspired by childhood memories. Musang also runs a not-for-profit, no questions asked, free meal program through their community kitchen, as well as a children's cooking program called Musang Little Wildcats. Melissa is committed to making Musang not just a traditional restaurant, but a community space that aims to educate the broader public about Filipino food and culture. Welcome. And lastly, but not least, Cha McCoy is also joining us tonight. Cha is a sommelier, public speaker, and beverage programmer. She is the founder of Cha Squared Hospitality and Consulting LLC. She also served as Charleston Wine and Food Festival Beverage Director, Cherry Bomb Magazine's first beverage director and editor for their new vertical Cherry Bomb Drinks, and the brand ambassador for New York Wine and Grape Foundation. Cha is a certified sommelier with the Court of the Master Sommeliers and holds an executive certificate in wine management with Universidad Católica Portuguesa, I hope I said that right, in Lisbon. Cha has been recognized by the Wine Enthusiast as top 40 under 40 tastemakers and Wine and Spirits magazine's Rising Black Voices in Wine. Welcome, everyone. Thanks so much for being here tonight.
Yay. Thank you, Magna. Welcome, everyone. I am so psyched to have you three here. I have been looking forward to this talk for like weeks. So I would like to start the way I start all of these talks that I've been doing with the library, which is to ask you a little bit about your path. Because whenever I see people doing cool shit in the world, I want to know, like, how did you get here? Where did you come from? How did you get this passion? Like, what was your path in getting here? So I would like, I'm going to give you a question, questions in turn, but I would like to find out where you're from originally, what you do in your own words, because sometimes, especially like people have an idea of what a chef does or a sommelier or cookbook author, but like, what do you spend the bulk of your days doing? And then kind of like, when did you know this was what you wanted to do, or how did you get on this path in a nutshell? So I will start, let's start with Tara. Will you go first?
I will absolutely go first. But as I'll admit, as you went through that, the idea of saying what I do in a day, that's a tough question. So let's back it up to how I got here. Originally from Montreal, Quebec, but raised in Southern Ontario, which is where I live now. I was a person that's always loved food. It's such an old trope to say that I came from a food-loving family, but it's very much the case. I never thought I'd have a career in food, though, because one of the things I learned was that I knew I wasn't built for restaurant kitchens. And that was, and what I wanted was the story behind food. And I was a person that always read cookbooks, like novels, but I always wanted to go one step further. Unfortunately, when I had to make that decision of what to do with my life, at that time, food media wasn't then what it is now. And it was either go into kitchens, or the very few and far between areas of food writing were for former chefs or food critics. And I'm not a food critic either. So instead, I went into journalism, went into communications, that took me into the corporate world, and I burnt out so damn fast. And so it happened to be that time when food blogs were this nascent thing, and I decided to start one up as a way to actually get back to writing in my own voice. I knew that food was the topic that was inexhaustible to me. It was a way of telling story. It was a way of finding hopefully like-minded people out in the world. I didn't think anything would come of it. I thought then maybe I could start volunteering at publications, go the old-fashioned routes. But it happened to be that point that everything coalesced and digital media exploded. So that was 2005. And I have been writing consistently about food for the last 16 years. That turned into magazine columns first and foremost. Then came my cookbook. Then came working for other magazines, television, that all kind of blew up from there. So I don't know if at times that I had a path set out for me. I honestly always thought that I was just going to be a byline in best case scenario. But as the people have so opened up to new voices, doesn't matter where you're from, doesn't matter your background exactly. It matters the passion, it matters the interest, it matters that you have the drive to do so. That's just kind of opened up doors, and I've been lucky enough to go through them. What I do every day is utterly changeable, as was so kindly said in my introduction. Sometimes I'm taking people on travel, as you do, Olaiya. I'm working on a television show right now as a cultural consultant, actually, because one of the characters happens to be a cook of Gujarati descent, and they decided to bring me on to work with scripts, as well as to be on some set days to talk about whether or not how you'd garnish a dish. So I love that there's something like that. And then at the same time, I'm still writing columns and hopefully doing another book. And so days are very changeable. But that's sort of what I do. And that's me in a nutshell.
I love it. Thank you for sharing. First of all, I do not like the fact that you said, you know, you kind of started out in 2005 and that was 15 years ago. I was like, that was 15 years ago, right? No, like that was 15 years ago now. And then also what you said about that you discovered quickly that you were not built for restaurant kitchens. I'm really glad that you mentioned that, because I think a lot of people think that the only way into a career in food is by working your ass off in a restaurant kitchen. And I had a very similar situation. I worked in restaurants for a long time, front of the house, back of the house. But I knew, like, for me, both in terms of the damage it does to your body and in terms of my personality and tolerance for stress, that was not for me. So I'm so glad you called that out, that like, that is not the only path to go. So thank you. Perfect. Cha, you want to tell us a little bit about where you're from? What's your background? What do you do?
Yes. Well, thanks for bringing me here. And I love to hear that I have another East Coaster here with me representing. So I'm from New York. I am more specifically from Harlem. I always say I'm Harlem American. And I think that growing up in a city that's so diverse culturally, the food come with it. And so it's easy that growing up with my dad, who was, you know, the ultimate foodie, you know, before I even know who the hell James Beard was, I just know it was my father who was like, we got to go to Queens so we can get this tonight, and let's go up to Washington Heights. Like, he was that guy. And so Thank God there was no Instagram, because I think my father would be taking the pictures most of the time. But yeah, so I kind of grew up with this idea of cultural identity from different neighborhoods surrounded around food. And I think that this interesting, my father did study culinary and had a small restaurant in Harlem at one point. But I always remembered him pairing everything perfectly with beer. So he always needed to know, like, what was the cultural, like, what was, like, if we're having Indian food, what's, like, the go-to beer if he was in India? So to be honest, I think I thought my father actually traveled to most of these places because he may know a couple of words or two as far as language-wise. He may, you know, he could kick it with anybody, and he actually would just drink what the locals drink. And so I think that stuck with me when people start asking me about, like, my earliest memories about being in beverage, since I'm such a champion for how we imbibe. And so I've taken on the art of gathering from a, you know, beverage perspective. And so it's beyond my work as a sommelier. It's more about, like, how do beverage bring people to the table, as much as, you know, whether it's culturally, because we're in Morocco drinking mint tea. So beverage also plays a role, the same way my food friends here talk about, you know, cuisine. So I'm here doing a lot of history work related to that and making sure that people have these various experiences. Now, I know you had three questions, so I might be talking about them all in circles now, but I hope I'm bringing them home. So I started in the industry at a wine shop. I actually was doing my MBA in Rome, Italy. That's how I learned about wine. Not related. I was not studying wine. I was actually just, you know, being immersed in the culture. So that means a lot of pasta, a lot of wine, all the things. And I came back with wine knowledge, as I like to say, a souvenir from my 2 years of living in Italy. And that was 2010 when I moved there. And my first job was in a wine shop, boutique shop in the newly gentrified Harlem when I returned home, and really was excited to have my newly minted MBA, as I say, but yet I wanted to have that same cultural connection that I left. So I dove all the way in, just straight into, like, how do I get more information, studying behind my mentor, who is the buyer of the store. And long story short, or bring you to today, that led to me actually, you know, doing my certifications as a sommelier, studying. At that time, I was studying just to get, like, I don't know nothing about wine, like, just getting my foundation in place. Then it was like studying for professionally, like, okay, now I know something, now I'm ready to go test, you know? So that's a different thing. People need to take a break and just kind of like just read the books, get a lay of the land. It was a new industry for me, since my background and what I was studying before was all related to engineering. So unlike others here, I did not grow up in hospitality, just more of a fan of it. And I love talking about transitioning into hospitality and still feeling like, you know, kind of insecure when you're like, I don't have 15 years of being in restaurants, but will they accept me? And how do I get in? So I usually try to champion anybody trying to come into the industry and how to still make money, especially leaving a job as an engineer. I have a high expectation for salary that I had to meet, you know, as far as taking care of myself too. So I don't know if I answered all the questions, but I think I covered most.
Yeah, you did. And I'm glad that you called out something that I didn't have down to talk about, that I'm glad you called out, is that you had a mentor, which I think is very important, like in any industry, but especially in the food industry. And I love also calling out that, like, again, you didn't come from this like, you know, straight out of college or instead of college. Like, I got certified as a somm. I started working in restaurants. I worked my way up, that there's a lot of different ways into the food and beverage industry. And for everybody watching, I just want to call out that if you want to hear more about Cha's story, which is really fantastic, all about her time in Rome and as an engineer and like starting her whole life over and her path in more detail, there is a podcast episode, Lioness Podcast. I will have to look up which one, about wine pleasure with Cha McCoy. You should check it out. Sesha, if you're able to find a link, that would be awesome.
Let me say what I do every day. And I'll tell you that quick, which is probably very difficult to explain, but just understand my work as a wine consultant do incorporate me creating wine lists and beverage lists for different restaurants and events. One of my largest clients now is me working as the head of beverage for Charleston Wine and Food Festival. We just released our program last Thursday, or at least two Thursdays ago. So that's over 120 different experiences in the city of Charleston from March 2nd to the 6th. And you can only imagine the amount of my brain, the way my brain felt after tickets went live. It's like, I can't take any programming back. It's out there in the world and it's open. And this is a very important role. I do think I'm one, to be honest. I don't know if there's any other of these top large wine and food festivals that's out there in the world that's being programmed with someone of color being the decision maker on what's happening, who's speaking. So it's definitely I have a sense of pride of taking on this role and to bring other people in to Charleston to be able to share and do the same storytelling that I do everywhere else. But now we get to do all in one house, you know, as far as in Charleston. So that's what I do every day now, is talking to the different Psalms, the different restaurants, trying to do a little matchmaking, make sure we have some amazing programming. So that's what takes up most of my time in the week, let's just say.
I love that. And I'm going to go check it out because Charleston is actually my favorite food city in the US. So I'm going to have to go check that out. Awesome. Thank you. And Melissa, will you tell us a little bit about where are you from? Are you a hometown person? Are you from Seattle? And how did you get on this path? How did you start your restaurant? How did you know you wanted to be a chef?
It was really interesting and beautiful to hear Cha's story. I think that there's a lot of similarities in how we came up. I am a Seattle native, born and raised. My parents both immigrated here. My dad came here in the 70s. My mom came here in the 80s. They met at a Halloween party. But they are the focal point of a lot of where my food, my love for food comes from. Coming from a big Filipino family, we spent all the weekends celebrating together. We spent time eating out, traveling together. So it kind of felt like Christmas every weekend, which I feel is like something very special to being, you know, Filipina and being a person of color, because there's a lot of importance surrounding family and at the table surrounded with food and drinks. Let's see, similar to Cha, I actually graduated from the University of Washington. I'm a sociology major as well, or not an engineer, but I got my degree and thought that I was going to be on an entirely different path. But during college, I actually was introduced to the hospitality industry, and I worked in the front of house and was just blown away by the camaraderie and the family aspect that becomes part of it, that you're introduced to folks that you never would have the opportunity to meet, and how those people can change your life paths, and how that in itself is a university. I moved to Florence, Italy, and I actually lived in Florence for 5 years, where I went to culinary school and honed my craft and learned my philosophies and really kind of understood where that passion of mine was from. It grew from my grandmother, who would cook for me as a child, and my father. And just seeing how like the differences in cultures, there's so many similarities that occur in food. So something that you would eat in Italy can taste something so familiar in Filipino food, and exploring that. After that, I spent time in New York, and I just felt like, you know, everyone's like, this is the culinary capital of the world and you can earn your chops. And I definitely learned a lot about myself. I learned a lot about management. I learned a lot about being a woman of color in this industry, and how I did not want to run my restaurant or my kitchen. I learned that there is a lot of things that still need to be addressed. And so when I moved back home, that was really my kind of focus and goal, was to try and introduce a new model, introduce a new way for us to be able to create something that is grounded in community first and foremost, and then in food and our food stories. I say that I don't really consider myself a chef. There's a lot of like difficult connotations that have been attached to that. And I'm working really hard within myself and my team and my community to help show that we can be more and that we are more. There's a lot of us that I feel like we're actually healers in this space, because through our food, we heal, through our stories, we connect. And so that's kind of where I'm at. We opened up a restaurant here in Seattle right before the pandemic, and we survived. And we also introduced the idea of a community kitchen. And what does that look like? I've always said that this space isn't a chef-driven space. It's a community space, and it's a chance for my team to be able to develop their skills and feel empowered to tell their own stories. You know, during the pandemic, we were forced to close down, but I just couldn't close the restaurant. Like, we had just started. And in order for us to really follow the philosophy that we follow, it's like, if you take care of your community will take care of you. So throughout the pandemic, we did that. We still have a community kitchen program that exists. We have a lot of incredible partnerships here in Seattle where we continue to feed the community. And it's been really cool to see that the things that we had set out to do in the beginning, even though the pandemic was a bit of a deterrent, like, we are here and we're doing our best to take care of our employees and just be an example for folks that there can be a different kind of model.
I love that so much. So first of all, Seattle fam, get after it, book your reservations and Musang, support, be part of the community supporting this amazing business. And second of all, I love that you called out a few things. So like the family and camaraderie aspect that I've heard, like Everett, Tara and Cha and myself, that everybody's had that, you know, for me, it was my grandma, maybe your father, your family, whatever, that how intimately linked food is with community, with family. And it's a testament to the power of food, both to express love and to build community. So I love that everyone's called that out in some form. And I also love the concept behind this restaurant, kind of as, for me, it serves as a new model, as a model of like a new feminist economy, if you will. None of this like, yes, chef, like hurling, like, you know, carrots at people's head or whatever, like that extremely patriarchal, like top down, just listen, shut up and listen to me, that abusive restaurant culture. So I love that you're creating an example of what is possible in the world. I'm so here for it. Thank you for sharing. Okay, I want to be mindful of time. This goes so fast when we have three panelists. I would like to talk about kind of next about two sides to one coin. So I would like to talk about the challenges of working in food as a person of color, and then also the unique gifts that you bring to your work as a person of color. Part of the inspiration for this talk was the scandal that happened at Bon Appetit. I won't go into all of the details on that. If people who are watching don't know about that, they can kind of go Google and check that out. But it really brought to light, like, staff members of color were not being treated and compensated fairly, which brought to light how widespread that is across the industry. It exposed some huge inequities in the world of food publishing. And then it expanded out to a larger examination of the abuse, sexism, and racism that still exists in the food industry. So I want to call that out. I want to talk about what that can look like, but then I don't want to leave it there. I'd also like to talk about the flip side of the coin. Like, I'd like people to understand what that can look like, but then also, like, what do we bring as people of color to our work that nobody else could bring? So how about if we start, let's go backwards. Okay, nice. Let's start with Melissa.
Hey, the question is
challenges and your unique gifts. What do you bring as a person of color?
Yeah, I mean, obviously challenges in this industry is this system that has been built before us. You know, a lot of folks are like, it's broken, but it's not really broken. It's just built in a way that has been in the advantage of a lot of people for a really long time. So the challenge is being a fresh voice, it's being a leader, it's being someone that is willing to self-examine, is willing to self-reflect and be aware in order to grow and make actual change. You know, I have moments where I was in Italy and New York, and like, I'm here, I am a woman who probably they're used to being quiet or not, you know, very loud spoken. And I feel like, when I did open my mouth, it was one of those opportunities to really just try and advocate for myself. But it is a challenge, you know. I think for a lot of folks in this industry, I know it's also a challenge in the wine industry as well, and in the publishing industry. You know, bringing up Bon Appetit has been such an eye-opening thing, and what that did, and like how we can be or try and be advocates for ourselves in those situations. Challenges is like not being taken seriously. You know, like, I was just talking to my manager earlier about, like, I went somewhere to buy something, but I wasn't given the same attention I would have been given if I was a man. Or I'm like trying to like purchase something or trying to like command a room. And I think that I hope, and it's incredible being in space with you and sharing space with you all, is that we are leaders. We are, you know, taking on that, you know, hidden burden of really becoming the advocates for those and for the next generation. I think it's really incredible that you're asking how we are unique in this, because I think oftentimes in these situations, only the bad gets talked about. And I think that in order for change to also happen is we need to highlight and focus on the folks that are doing the good work. I think those voices need to be elevated more, because then when folks get to see that it is existing or it's being successful or the way that we are approaching things, like more people can follow. So I think that kind of platform has been incredible. I think for myself, I can definitely attest that like my life journey, which was not traditionally like in the kitchen model or like coming up in that way, has been my unique gift, because all of my experiences from traveling, from working in the front, from working in the back, has given me a different perspective and a lot brighter perspective in how I look at the future of this industry. I think, you know, we were able to take on all those challenges that happened during the pandemic without being crushed, because it was like, we need to survive. And as people of color, we are resilient. We are going to show that resiliency by not stopping, by doing what we know what to do best. Like, this is who we are.
You're giving me goosebumps. And, yes.
And that is what I think is unique to who we are. And I think being able to be vulnerable, I have been somewhat kind of thrusted into this space and position of being like a Filipina leader for my community. And it wasn't something that I ever thought in my life that I would take on or be, you know, seen as a representative of that. But in that, I think there's so much that I know I can share and learn from this perspective. And it's one that is rooted in the community. It's rooted in the awareness and vulnerability, because, you know, our whole lives we've been fed this like hide your feelings and do this and all that. And I think that in order for us to really be able to grow and make change, like, you see me and that's what I am. So,
yeah. So well said, such a good answer. Thank you. And I just want to remind everybody listening, if questions are coming up as you are watching and listening, please drop them into the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. Thank you so much. Such a good answer. And let's go back. How about Tara? Do you want to talk a little bit about challenges as a person of color in food publishing, and then also your, the unique gifts that you bring?
Well, I actually have an anecdote that ties very much into your introduction, and that is Bon Appetit, because it just so happened that I was writing for Epicurious during all of that. And many people don't know that Epicurious and Bon Appetit actually share a good amount of their editorial staff. That all kind of came to light in about June, I think it was, like late May, early June. Just so happened that I had a story assigned by Epicurious in March that was about dosas. So South Indian dosas, and I had been recently made a contributor, so suddenly my articles were going to have my face beside it. The name Tara O'Brady, of course, does not give you an idea that it's going to be a brown girl writing that article. But because of the pandemic, the article was put on hold. And coincidence, the article was going to come out now, right after everything came out with Bon Appetit. So lo and behold, visually, it would suddenly be that you had a primer on dosas written by a woman of South Asian descent, just as all of this came to light. Mm-hmm. And I had such a sinking feeling in my soul, because the last thing I wanted to do was to be part of someone else's redemption arc. Because even though I knew my editor, who was a wonderful person, had assigned me this months ago, to everyone else, I was just going to be the token brown person that they shelved in. and I didn't want to be part of those flames. So, and I was very lucky in many ways that I felt that there was a structure at Epicurious. I went to the editor and I told him that. I said, can we have a headnote that has a timeline of what, how this all came about? What can we do? That ended up turning into a 1500 word essay. It was called The Color of My Skin is Sometimes Confused with the Scope of My Talent. And Epicurious was quite kind to allow me to have that run alongside the Dosa story. And that article really does go into a lot of detail of the challenges it is that, that we face, the myriad ways that we face microaggressions in the ways that our talents are somehow dissuaded and they're somehow considered less when they happen to match our culture. It's like that we just think that we magically came out of the womb and know how to make Filipina food, know how to pair wines somehow because of the cultural aspect to it. And it's considered lesser than a person that takes it on by choice. The restrictions that sometimes that we get, like right now we're at the start of Diwali and I have to tell you my phone rings 2 months before Diwali that suddenly everyone wants content, but those selling outlets might not be talking to me at Christmas time. Or the idea that anytime I demo, when my cookbook came out, so many people wanted me to do the Indian recipes, and there's probably 3 Indian recipes in a cookbook with 100 recipes in it. And so there's a lot of those ideas. It's the preconceived notions of what type of cook you should be or what type of person you should be. It should also be your skill set. Baking is actually what I'm best at. French and Italian cooking is what I'm best at because I cooked everything except Indian food when I started out because that was my way of really setting myself apart. And yet editorial didn't want to see that. I remember when I did my cookbook, someone saying to me, people might not want biscuits from you, but I make damn great biscuits. So I said, biscuits are going in the book. I went down to Louisville and got flour just so I could have Southern flour and smuggled it across the Canadian border. Biscuits are really important to me, but it's that idea. It's the idea of it where you realize it doesn't matter how you see yourself, that when you are a marginalized individual, so much of the time it matters how the majority sees you. And until you are willing to butt up against that and kind of tear that down and work within that system, you're going to still be constrained by that. So that is sort of the challenges of what gets us here. But I think Melissa did such a wonderful job because we have so many strengths that are born out of those challenges. We don't have the luxury in many ways of not being advocates. So often in the last year, people have asked, how do you know so much? Or how do you speak so well about these things? It's like, because I was never given a choice not to. Because if I didn't talk about what it was like to be, undercut or undervalued, or to understand that something is systemically racist or sexist, if I wasn't going to be the voice in the room, then there was no voice in the room. I had to do it. And when you are forced to have that burden that Melissa said about of educating oneself, of being able to have that you then, of course, take that to everything that you do. And I think that we have a dexterity because of that. We have an ability to see outside of our own perspectives in such a wonderful way because we're used to having to take on the perspectives of larger society. Why is it that we know how to pronounce words outside of our culture just because of the fact that society at large does? So I think there's a wonderful dexterity there. I think we have a creativity because of that. I think also non-Western societies also have a sense of collectivism largely. We talk about sisterhoods, we talk about our villages, we talk about the idea of all of us bringing each other up. And I think that in so many ways that works into the way that we interact with each other. It's the way that we cheer each other on. And it's the way that we understand that there is not a scarcity to success. That if one of us succeeds, we all succeed. That it rises the tide for all of us. So I think we've got just as many challenges as we had, as Melissa so eloquently said, we have so much to offer to meet those challenges.
Yes, so well said, like called out so many things that are important. And I really appreciate you calling out specifically that non-white cultures or non-Western cultures have, I feel like, an access to like ancestral knowledge or like a sense of collectivism that is a really valuable tool, especially in the space of food that is so much about bringing people together, so much about food, and that perhaps there's maybe even a little bit more of a perspective of like food as healing, food as community than you might find in more Western society. So I love that you called that out. Thank you. Such a good answer. What about you, Cha? What have been some of your biggest challenges as a person of color in the wine industry, beverage industry, and then what are some of your strengths and gifts that you bring as a person of color?
It was great listening to both ladies, and I think that the first word I thought about when Melissa was talking about is like lacking privilege, right? So a lot of when I talk about beverage, it comes from a place of like, we don't have the privilege to be able to do less, just have a hobby. Like, I mean, I guess I would have loved to continue doing my job and just making wine my hobby, but I had to become very focused, take exams when other people probably didn't have to take any because they followed and they owned the restaurant. You know, like I didn't have that ability. I had to go in, go hard, you know, give up my whole career. And not have, inheritance to like, oh, let me cash in, grandpa, and I'm going to go start my wine bar tomorrow. Like, I literally have to really hustle. So a lot of people call me a wine hustler. And I guess at one point I was like, as someone who studied international finance, it's pretty weird to be like, I don't like talking about money. But I think it's because it's just mentally just kind of like, you're just so used to like growing up being broke, you know? So I guess it's this place of like not having that to like hold on to. I don't have a family that's going to allow, like I can cash in on my dreams with them. Like I want to switch my major, mom, you know, that's not a thing for me. So I had to like make a whole life decision to change and do all of the hard work to like now make money from this dream of mine in order to be like a successful adult, like for me to take care of myself, which is the bare minimum. I have any, you know, and hopefully one day, right, the idea is that I'm building a platform for myself that will allow me, as you hear much in most of our cultures, I'm sure, is about legacy, right? You know, like as much as we know, someone mentioned in a podcast I was listening to earlier, you know, they like saying, do it for your last name. You know, Black folks come up with anything cool, like, do it for your last name. I'm like, yeah, I'm rallying for that. And I think that it was fun when the idea of like the Rockefellers, they was comparing, like people don't even know what the Rockefellers did, but we know the last name. And that's the whole point, is that we don't have the privilege to do this. So when we give into a passion, we got to be the LeBron James. We can't settle for anything less. In order for our family to take us serious, especially if we're not engineers, lawyers, doctors, et cetera, and for ourselves to be able to make enough money to bring other people with us, right? You build in community, we know money talks. So if you want to do a community kitchen, if you want to be able to be an imprint and help other cookbook authors one day, you got to bring in money. And so I think that this continuous effect that I keep telling myself that I see as a challenge is that as much as I want to be sitting back with the bros drinking natural wine, to be honest, I got to take on clients that, you know, they're okay. Look, the wines is like, you know, fourth generation winemakers and things like this. And but they're the ones with the money, and they're the ones that I'm able to pitch things to and have them understand the concepts may be difficult, but I'm willing to do the work in order to bring the money in so I can hire somebody else, you know. So one day I will have the luxury to be able to go, okay, I only want to talk about the wines that I want to talk about, only female winemakers or only winemakers of color or et cetera. But I don't even have the privilege to do that right now. So I actually have to continue to be a part of this capitalist society that continues to let them thrive. I have to play the game, you know, in order to be able to build something for people in the future. So, you know, a lot of words are put next to my name, but I think more or less is that I hope that the people who come after me, the generations come after me, will one day see that it's almost like I always compare stories about like what you hear about folks that come before you, right? This idea of, I'm just trying to pay it forward. So someone next after me, whether they're related to me or not, have the ability to go, nah, I don't want to work with none of those winemakers. I only want to work with these people who are respecting the land, who are respecting this, you know, versus people I got to work with in order to make the money to give to those one, you know, like it's like a cycle or ecosystem you have to be fully aware of. So I think that one of the largest challenges that I think of, especially after Melissa spoke, was about privilege. And then, it's, you know, hearing Tara speak, it was like, how do I actually think about what I am bringing to the table that is still, you know, something that I hope is respected as, you know, still a gift. And I can only imagine, you know, this comes beyond race. I think it's just being raised in New York City, you know? So for me, being around all the cultures, I'm okay with traveling and being around different people and growing up eating Vietnamese food and eating Indian food in London and kicking it with whoever, you know? So I feel like being a New Yorker allows me to take on diversity from a different perspective beyond my own myself. And I would think that even if you had a cis white male from New York also is different than someone from South Carolina, you know? So I feel like the idea of also being a New Yorker and being a Black female allows me to be a more assertive, more in rooms where people may feel uncomfortable. You know, now also talking about working in South Carolina and doing work where people are like, this is the beverage director? Like, you know, so they like, you know, and I really have to come correct and understand the rules and who they're expecting in the room that's making decisions. Like I have in the past, is no different. But I think the difference is here is that culturally, there are still places that still have, the needle has not changed. So I'm showing up in this, in spaces where I am trying my best to be as political as possible. And I think in being able to wear the, you know, different mask if we need to, you know, being able to, like we've had to like be able to be flexible in different rooms, be silent when we need to, listen more, you know, speak when, you know, when you feel like this is safe, you know, I'm not saying because somebody asks you, but you feel safe. Someone hears what you're saying. I don't know if this is, I'm like, hold on, maybe this is not as much as a benefit. And then I'm thinking about it. But I do feel like this is really a gift, you know? And I do feel like being able to have learned that because of the color of my skin, the way my hair look, all the things that people assume that I'm not. So I'm in rooms where people don't pay attention to me at all. Don't realize I'm the one making all the decisions, you know? So I'm able to be unnoticed. So I don't like the idea of being invisible, but I do think it allows me to fly under the radar and then be able to show up strong because I'm already strong. And so I'm able to be able to command the room when it's time for me to speak and not because of, you know, I need you to know who's boss, you know, like, you know, like that kind of male gender, like kind of idea of them, like, you know, everyone listen to me, you know, I'm fine with, you know, being in the background, listening. And then when it's time to execute, the people who know me know it's time to rock. And so I think that comes a lot with just kind of knowing how I'm raised in New York, but also knowing that a lot, I'm unassumingly, you know, the person that they're going to think they're going to have the answer to in the next year or two. So hopefully that's still, I don't want to say that's a gift, but maybe it's a secret weapon. I don't know.
I think so. I love so many things that you called out there. First of all, I think that like a gift for many people of color working across industries, but especially in food, I've heard in each of your answers, this attention to, Cha, you called out bringing other people with us, which is so important, that strength, that real commitment to like, let's open doors for other people. Let's show other people what's possible. Let's use our dollars and our privilege and our connections to bring other people with us. I think that's so, so, so important. And then also, I think it's really, you called out something else that's really important that I'm sure that all three of you are doing that is super courageous, which is to show up in those spaces and to like, okay, so people aren't expecting a female Filipina chef. People aren't expecting someone who looks like you, Cha, to be like leading this beverage program in South Carolina, right? Tara, people aren't expecting, like they hear your name and they're like, who is this woman writing about dosas? And then so I think it's very, I just want to call out and celebrate you that it is super courageous to show up in these spaces, to be political the way that all three of you are, to like put that message out there in addition to your talents for cooking, writing, being a sommelier. So celebrating that big time. I want to be respectful of time. We don't have a ton of time left. I just want to check, like if we go over a tiny bit, like 5 or 10 minutes, is that okay? Do you have obligations? Okay. Okay, so I want to get in at least one more question before we end. And just a reminder to people watching, feel free to drop questions in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And I guess the thing I would like to talk about next is, it's kind of a segue into what we've been talking about, but it's about representation. So there are lots of people of color who work in the food industry, right? The food and beverage industry, hospitality industry. But many of them are doing dishes, bussing tables, doing laundry in hotels, and not that those jobs are without dignity. I absolutely don't think that those jobs are super important and we all need to recognize that. But I also think there's a paucity of people of color in positions of leadership and ownership in many industries, but especially in the food industry. So I would love to hear your thoughts on how do we get more somms and chefs and authors who are, get them the respect that they deserve, get them the compensation that they deserve. So what are your thoughts on how we can increase representation at the leadership level in food and wine, both from inside communities of color within your communities? And I always like to call out, like, how can people be good allies? Like, real, what are some meaningful things? So if you care to speak to either of those or both, that's fine. So let's start. How about we start with you, Cha?
I just had this conversation with someone because allyship is getting real watered down. It's getting real trendy and cheesy. Like it's at an all-time high of fakeness right now. And I think that there's a lot of brands that want to, you know, she mentioned earlier about, Tara mentioned about the article, and that just hits because I just, you know, actually, especially working in media and knowing what that feels like is crazy. And watching it happen a lot of times just is, it's gross, to be honest. And so even though that wasn't her case, but that's what, you know, it kind of would be able to be used, is that the article was written before, but the idea is that because it happens all the time. So that's why the larger world believe this is the norm, you know, that they're gaslighting you in this way. So the question is more about time for about leadership, you know, and I think that one, let you know, how do we get people to actually like just be informed? We mentioned this even for a second before about like books. Like I feel like we don't even dream bigger. Like sometimes it's not about nobody else giving you permission but yourself. Kind of like starting, and I just happened to have someone who, like, I got an MBA. So when I came into this business, I was not like, oh, I'm gonna be the somm so I can make $100,000. I was already making over six figures because I was an engineer. So I had a different perspective. So I was like, in my head, when I come into hospitality, how do I own something in hospitality? You know, it wasn't about like, I'm going to wash dishes one day to wake up to do this, and then I'm going to eventually have six figures. No. So I think that I try my best. Even my peers and people who are older than me who actually been working, they come to me like, Cha, does this contract sound right? And not because I'm somebody's lawyer. Sometimes I'm just trying to be a good ally so that my friends is being fairly compensated, because they know I negotiate hard on my contracts. I'm like, you're not giving me a penny short of what I'm worth. And if not, have a good night. And so I feel like allies who don't look like us, who are given, you know, this is not us in the room saying this, you can read the facts, Black women, women of color, in general, we're getting paid less, right? So in this case, and I'm getting paid less than Asian women, right? So in this, so how do these women feel confident when they're looking at their contract to ask for more when they know they're gonna get less anyway, you know? So I feel like even having our white female counterparts who are doing the same thing, if they wanna be real allies, be open to tell how much you're getting paid for that same gig, you know, like, you must know one friend. I'm not saying you got to put on an Instagram. I'm saying, like, you know, just help a sister out, literally. And I really feel like that's one way to be able to help somebody, but at the same time, make sure that she is getting her right pay by just asking her too. Maybe she don't feel confident with sharing. Leadership roles. I really think that now since last year, everyone's all like, oh, let's make sure we put people in these places. But I recognize as someone who's now been tossed around in some of these roles, a lot of them want to put us in these places, but they don't want to give us the ability to make the decisions that we have to. If you put me on an executive level, if there's a director, manager, name my name, executive, all these fancy words, and I don't have the decision-making power to do what that title say, then yeah, baby girl, this is gaslighting again, 2.0, you know? And so I feel like now that people are willing to give up the titles, they're not allowing us to have the power. And so I feel like for me, this is where I have most of the most issues that I see, is that now that they are willing to say, oh yeah, Cha and whoever, yeah, you can get that title, and then they put it all over Instagram, everybody's so excited and stuff. But I think that at the end of the day, if you're not willing to actually give people the control, if I'm like, okay, well, now that we're here, it's time, let's get to business. And they're like, oh, we just kind of like did that for like, you know, that goes back to the article again. It's like, what? Like, I thought I was here to make change happen. I thought I was, you know, and I don't mean as a Black woman, because no one hired me to be your diversity expert. Let me say that real clear. I was a Black woman. I am not an expert in diversity. I want to put that out there for it to be recorded, because for some odd reason, that's also being confused. I'm like, you need to hire someone who do DEI work. I don't do that. I work in drinks. You want to know how to make a martini? You know, that's, you know, you want to know what wine goes well for your Thanksgiving dinner? I'm your girl. So I feel like that also is something that I'm realizing is being real confused now, where they feel like, oh, we could check two boxes here with you. And I'm like, not with me. I don't know how to do that kind of work. So I just want to make sure that's clear and on the record, you know, for the folks that's listening.
Yes, I love that. First of all, calling out that, like, for people to come in, like, first, that internal work of coming in with that, like, ownership or that leadership level mindset, just like thinking that you can do it. And that is the reason that I, not to be like overly self-congratulatory, but that is the reason that I think like talks like this are so important, or just like amplifying other voices, resharing on Instagram, just so people can see what is possible. Like, I still get pissed off thinking about all of the things that like young me, like, didn't know, like in rural Illinois, like in a white community, like all the things that I didn't know and the people that I didn't see in these roles. So I think it's so important. I love that you called that out. And I also wanted to share that there is a couple of resources that, Cha, you made me think of. One is that there is actually a database of author advances. And I don't know what it's called, Tara. I don't know. You can maybe speak to that in a minute, but if we can find it, drop a link. If not, you can Google it. That for people wanting to write cookbooks, and you go in there and it is astounding. And people also write, I think it includes sexual orientation and race. That it's optional to put those in, but to look at the variability in pay across that is really eye-opening. So resources like that are super valuable. There's another resource called Equity at the Table, which is basically an aggregate for women and queer folks who work in, I think, women, non-binary people and queer folks who work in food. And it's a database where you're like, okay, I need a food photographer. How can I find a food photographer of color? I need a caterer for this event. I need somebody to run my hospitality program at this hotel. So that's another really great resource that Stesha just dropped into the chat. And the last thing, you were talking about people just wanting to kind of use you as like a figurehead, like, let's drop a brown person in here. Let's drop a person of color in here. So like, oh, look how diverse we are. It just reminds me, like, so I play tennis, a very, very white sport. I was coming off the court the other day and this white man just grabbed, I'd never seen this man before in my life. And he's like, hey, do you want to be on the board of this program we have to help basically kids of color and underserved kids like get into tennis, which is something that I'm in favor of. But it was very clear that this man was just like, oh, brown person, let me just like grab her. And like, do you want to be on the board? Like, I don't know anything about your organization. I don't know anything about this. And you're just offering me a spot on the board. For me, that was like a red flag that this person is just like, let me just grab a Black person, any Black person, here you go. So I love calling that out as something to be wary of as a person of color and for white people to check themselves on. So thank you for that answer. Okay, how about, let's go back to Melissa.
All right. How can we bring leadership to the table?
Yeah, how can we increase representation? Get more people of color in leadership positions.
Yeah. Cha said something that was really kind of hit, that was like, so many of us in this industry had started off as dishwashers with the hope and mindset that maybe they would become owners. And I think there's such like a disillusionment to that, because so many people are fed that, when in actuality, that's not the truth. Most of the owners or folks that are in power have never really been advocates for the investment in the future generation. And I think in order for us to be able to bring out and give folks of color the platform to get into these leadership positions, we have to find ways where we can invest in them. That being said, it's really difficult. I mean, I'm sure some of you know, like, I'm a small business owner. I have a staff of 30 people, but you have to see where your values are and how that is in terms of advocating for them. So like, in order for me to bring people of color and have representation on my leadership team, it's like my leadership team is all women and they are all women of color and they all are strong and powerful and loud, and like we promote them, we give them space. I think that the idea of being able to invest in your employees, so like being able to offer them 401k, being awful to like being able to pay their medical insurance so that they can save their money, so that they can dream and get to a position where they can save. I think it's coming down to that foundational step. Like sometimes it's easy for me to like be like, okay, I'm gonna be an advocate, I'm gonna be out there, I'm gonna be like this voice in the space. But then sometimes like you take a step back and you're like, where, what am I doing in my house to make sure that that's where we really are going to go? I think giving people recognition when recognition is due. I think so much of our industry, we have been used, we have been taken advantage of. And I think that for me, I don't want that to happen to the future generation or the folks that are part of my team either. I think empowering them to be loud, to find their own voices is what's going to get them into the space, because they have been, I think, silenced for so long. I think in this cycle, this hamster wheel that has been passed down forever, you know, we as people of color have lost our voices because, you know, you are told to put your head down. You're told to just be like, okay, but you don't ever get to see those people, us representing them, because they aren't given that space. And so the more we put ourselves in places where it's like, yes, we built this, we did this, and now I'm going to give that back to you so that you can do that. And then this kind of creates this new model, this new cycle. I think that's really how we can start building and seeing that new future. Because I remember growing up as a kid and watching like Julia Child, and that was like my only person that, you know, was my mentor. But I'm like, but I have no idea, you know what I mean? Like, why am I not seeing like Pansit or like Lumpia or like Chicken Adobo on the screen? Like, why is it that that's not the case? And like, now that I feel like I'm here, and as hard as it is sometimes to be here, it's like, there are younger children that you see, you Tara, that see you Cha, and they're like, holy shit, I can be that person too. And you both are doing it in a way, and we're all doing it in a way that is like with intention, with care, and like with that motivation to be like, you're on the cover of a magazine, you're doing that. And like little kids, little brown kids, little black kids are like, oh my God, I can do that. I can be that. And I think just allowing ourselves to be part of this path, and like, I don't know, it's a crazy journey. I'm sure both of you know, all three of you know, but there are days that I'm reminded when like, there are younger kids or folks from all over the country that send you messages or let you know, like just seeing you doing what you do is enough to inspire. And that's how I think we can take over.
Yes, it is wildly important. And this is something that I love to talk about, and that really speaks to my heart, because like, as I mentioned, I'm biracial and I grew up in a white family in a white rural community in Illinois, like no brown people, no Asian people, no black, like nothing. There was just me. And like, so I really have this lived experience of this, like this scarcity of representation, and just seeing today, like sometimes I'm jealous, but happy, but just to see like what kids, like the different role models that kids have today in all these fields, I think it's so important. And I sometimes think about how different, I love my life, but I think about sometimes like how different it would have been if back in the 80s, I had seen people who looked like me doing more awesome shit, like in more leadership positions and more. So I love that you call that out, so important. And I also hear you talking about self-accountability, just this like, which is something that we talk about, I have heard talked about a lot in terms of allyship, but I love you calling that out, that also for people of color, like to really be intentional. Look inside. Am I walking my talk? Am I doing it? How can I do more? And encouraging people to use their voices, approaching that with intention and care. Such a good answer. Love it. And how about you, Tara? What do you think is key for like increasing representation in the food industry, maybe particularly in publishing or anything that you want to speak to?
Well, it's unfair and impossible to follow Cha and Melissa with everything that they have just shared. We'll try. One thing that you did ask though also, and I just want to touch on really briefly, was that why does representation matter? And I think Melissa just got it right there. And I think about Halloween, and this is, I remember being a little kid and dressing up at Halloween and people not knowing who I was because I didn't have blonde hair and blue eyes. And I was dressing up as like somebody who had that. And then just this other day, I saw a little blonde girl dressed up as Moana and I had no idea who she was, because she had blonde hair, and for the first time it was flipped around that I didn't know she was Moana. I just thought she was dressed in like a lei. I didn't realize, but she was so proud of being Moana. And that idea, like I remember sitting down and at a charity event and painting a little girl for this fair, and she said, I want to look like you because I want to look like Princess Jasmine. And it was the first time that I heard a little kid say that she wanted to look like me instead of me wanting to put lemon juice in my hair to make it look blonder. And for what we do in our daily lives, for what we do in our industries, it's Halloween every day. That exactly as you say, that people who are coming after us, it's the ability then to see themselves reflected. It's to see their food waste, it's to see their drink, it's to see the way that they connect with each other. Culturally, seeing that being given the same importance, it's being given that place of honor at the table. It's being given the importance of study, of discussion, of money and investment. And that idea of entrenched importance, it makes a difference to kids. And I hope that with what we do in our daily life in small ways, that just, you know, it continues that on. So I love that you mentioned that. And I just wanted to kind of reiterate that. Both of you also spoke so specifically about mentorship. And I think that is something that we really need to be aware of. And that mentorship can be in a very, because truthfully, food and wine is a community of who you know. People call up who they know when it comes to who you're going to hire next, or who's got a great server that they knew, or who are you going, what wine producer or wine agency you're going to work for. Usually it's through referral. And unfortunately, those referrals come from going to the same schools, being parts of the same clubs. You know, everyone's dated everyone else. So the thing that we can actively do in a lot of ways is the choosing the way that we mentor people. And so maybe that is taking a chance on somebody. That's why these the databases that we do have, like Equity at the Table, going outside of that circle sometimes to make sure that you're bringing in new voices in places that you can. So even if it isn't like a long-term mentorship, that is a way to mentor still. Another thing is really and truly, and I think both of these two talked about that, is that pay us. Like, where are the dollars? Like, pay us. How is this sustainable for us? I've, on a personal note, I have had many times that as a person who has a good tan and an easily pronounceable name, that companies want to put me as a spokesperson for an event, as a host. And then, but I have actually been asked if I would donate my time, because wouldn't it be wonderful? We just think it would be wonderful to have a woman of color in charge of this. So therefore, wouldn't you like to donate to the cause? This is my cause, people. You're getting paid to do this. You're not asking, no one's asking you to give up your salary, but because it's somehow my niche interest that I have to give up my hours, that my talent, that my skill doesn't have a monetary value, but somehow I'm going to do it to the betterment of others. And of course, that is a big part of what I do, but the only way I can keep doing what I do is if you pay me. So valuing these skill sets. You so often the price of a taco is determined by the color of the person who made said taco. Because if someone's going to put it on an expensive menu, like what's the difference between risotto and rice and beans? the color of the skin and that someone's going to charge you $24.95 for the risotto and they expect the rice and beans to come in at $4.99. There's no difference there.
Grits and polenta. Don't forget
grits and polenta. There you go. Like the list just keeps on going. So really and truly, like, get out your wallets, as crass as that sounds. But if we want to have this as a sustainable system, we need dollars in these economies. We need, because those who have money are those that survive. Because if we don't put money into a food waste, that should, then no one's going to make that food anymore because they can't live off making that food. That's just the reality of it. So as, you know, uncomfortable as that makes people feel, that is the difference between being accepting and being an ally. And that is the difference between being not racist and anti-racist. Both of those are active things, and it's that ability to make yourself be uncomfortable, and it's to make yourself maybe have a little bit less. It's to understand that there is a hierarchy to all of this. As Cha said, that knowing that as an Asian woman that I might make more than a Black woman for the same job, understanding my place in that, and where can I then give my privilege to help bring us all up to someplace equal. There is going to be discomfort, there is going to be challenge, but the idea of being truly an ally is to say that that burden is mine as well, even when I'm not vested into it because of the melanin in my skin.
Ooh, preach. So many good points. I love it. So first of all, when people are telling, we have these experiences of people telling me, like, do you want to donate your time? Like, I suggest that we all say, like, why don't you donate into my bank account? And then we can talk about it. Like, I hear this story over and over and over again, like, oh, wouldn't it be great to have a person on our board, or like, come chair this thing. And like, oh, the exposure that you'll get, like, exposure is great, but like, for this to be meaningful, like, you're asking me as a person of color to come do this because it brings value to your organization, pay me. And you said something else that I think is really important to talk about. You said it might sound crass, and I'm going to posit it, like, no shade whatsoever, but I'm going to posit that it would be very helpful to put out there the attitude that it is not crass, it is essential that we talk, especially as people of color, that we talk about money so that we understand, like, if we are being paid what we're worth. So people out there, think about it more, people who are making hiring decisions. So I would like to take away this veneer of, like, it's crass to talk about money, and maybe position it as part of activism, even, like this spreadsheet that Stesha did post, I believe, yeah, publishing paid me advanced spreadsheet. More spreadsheets like this, more talking about it publicly within your comfort level, of course, but I don't think it's crass at all. I think it's super important. So, so good to call out. And I could keep talking about this, like, literally for another hour, but I think we got to wrap it up because we're past time. And I don't see any questions in here. So I'm going to attribute that to the fact that these answers have been so freaking amazing, like, so, so, so good. Yeah, literally, like, I have so many more questions I could ask, but we have to wrap it up. So before we do, I would just, and because we're working in partnership with Book Larder, I would love it if you each could call out a book that has inspired you or that you go to that's a resource, just something that you'd like to share with the community, if you don't mind. Maybe starting with Melissa. I know you gave me a list. Like, what are some, do you remember some of those? Or not? Am I catching you off guard? Oh, wait, you're on mute.
I did. I pulled it up. I'm going to pull it up really quickly. Some of the books that I mentioned, I mean, most of them were cookbooks for myself, but there's this book that I recently read called Taste of Control, Food and the Filipino Colonial Mentality Under American Rule, written by Alexander D. Urquiza Jr. And I think there's so much information that is incredible to learn, especially for myself being Filipina, raised as a Filipino American, that has a country that was colonized and has lost their identity and culture, and how that has affected us and our successes here as young people, because we are unlearning the trauma and healing the trauma of that of many generations. And I don't think people understand that that's extra work that we have to do. That is extra work. And how we have to become educators to not only this next generation, but that of the past generation. I think that book was very empowering. And I just recently read Gemba Kaizen. It's a Japanese book on kind of how we can help with operations here and like how you can work on continuous growth day to day instead of this like, oh my gosh, I have this huge thing, but like if I can help with the systems now and create this incredible foundation, then we can grow and learn together. But yeah, those two things have been my book bag.
Awesome. I'm gonna go check out both of those. That sound amazing. And I see Stesha's dropping links in the chat. Thank you, Stesha. What about you, Cha? Any resources that have been inspirational for you or that you want to share with people? Oops, I think you're on mute.
Okay, here we go. Yes, so I did share a few more little boozier books than Melissa, but that's the nature of my game. And so Vignettes, Stories of Life in Wine in 100 Bottles. Author is Jay Lopes, he's a friend and a mentor to a lot of women who've been coming up in wine and as the more modern sommelier, but she's talking about everything from beverage to from tea to wines to cognacs and talking about her life through that, but she's also educating. So I think that the illustrations is done beautifully. So I love recommending that book.
Could you say the title one more time? There it is. Okay. Yeah.
The Sommelier's Atlas of Taste, A Field Guide to the Great Wines of Europe, was written by Master Sommelier Rajay Parr. I respect his work as a winemaker. And as if you go to my Instagram, I'm known as the traveling sommelier. So I respect anybody who brings both of my worlds together, travel and wine and exploration. And so he's talking about some of his favorite regions, sub-regions, and the people, more about the people. So I think that people forget that winemakers or producers are just grape farmers. So the idea of like getting you reintroduced to the land that the wine is from. And so I really love that book. And just on a non-wine one, since Melissa added that too, I had to like make sure I got the title right. Zim Flores, Z-I-M, last name Flores, F-L-O-R-E-S. She has a book out called Dare to Bloom. And I've been reading that throughout. It actually was released during the pandemic. So I've been taking, she has questions. I'm definitely like the self-help person. That's the section I live in personally when I'm not reading about wines and spirits. So in this case, Dare to Bloom, I've been taking chapter when I'm ready to do that self-work. I dive deep into a chapter, answer all the questions, reflect on it, and I may come back like a month later. So I don't try to speed read through it, but Zen Flores, Dare to Bloom is my everyday book, I should say.
Well, I'm definitely gonna check that out. I also live in the self-help, personal growth section of the library. Love it. And I haven't heard of this, so I will definitely go check this out. Thank you. And what about you, Tara? Do you have any recommendations to share with us?
Absolutely. I'll start with the cookbooks. I'll give you three very quickly. The first is To Asia with Love by Hattie McKinnon. It came out just a few months ago. It's a fantastic cookbook. So inspiring, and her flavors are bang on. Another one is Dishoom from Bombay with Love. Dishoom is a restaurant in London, and it is the Iranian cafes in South India. So this is absolutely, half of my family are South Indian, and this is absolutely food I crave, and delicious things there. The last one is Hawa Hassan's In Bibi's Kitchen, which is a recipes of the African continent as it touches the Indian Ocean. Hawa, of course, a complete and utter rock star, a dear friend, one of those builders of community in everything that she does, and just like a hero and a girl crush. And
I'd interrupt you really quick to throw in that I did an interview with her, an author talk that should be on the Book Larder YouTube channel.
Yeah. So, Hawa is that. A force of good and a force of nature, and one of those grounding people that I think we all need to learn from. And then last but not least, and this has nothing to do with food, but has to do with activism, it's See No Stranger, a memoir and manifesto of revolutionary love. It is by Valerie Carr, who is a Sikh American, and it is the story of her journey to activism that was very much born out of the attacks of 9/11 as a Sikh person that was frequently mistaken for Muslim, and what that meant for her, and this idea of moving forward, that we are that it is not about aggression, that it is about this idea of how we grieve together is how we grow together. It's how we share our pains and it's how we share our stories. It is that idea of building communities, a finding of where that we come, that we actually match up to each other to move forward in a positive way. It is still as strong, it is still moving forward with power, but it is doing so in a perspective that also deals with a lot of self-healing and self-love and a way that takes care of one's own spirit as you are advocating for others. So a fantastic book.
So good. Thank you everyone for sharing. And before I turn it back over to Meghna and Stesha, I just want to say thank you to the three of you for taking time for this talk. Like, I am a huge fan of everything you do, celebrating you, here for you, here to like amplify your voice. It's been an absolute delight and honor to speak with you and learn more about you. So thank you.
Thanks for having me.
Thank you. Thanks for having
Thanks for bringing us together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Hi, everybody. That was so great. Thank you so much. What a wonderful conversation. And so good. And I was frantically trying to drop links in the chat for folks with all those amazing books. So be sure and check those out. I also wanted to let folks know that there are a few more fun events that are coming up. On November 16th, food writer Mayuk Sen will talk with Angela Garbus about his new book, Tastemakers, which is about, I think, seven immigrant women who have, oh, are you gonna show us, Meghna? Yes, beautiful. So Book Larder is a partner on that program as well. And I will drop a link in the chat to that. And then don't forget to check out the two additional events scheduled in Olaiya's series, Radical Self-Acceptance as Activism. The next event is on Monday, November 15th and features Caroline Dooner. And she and Olaiya will talk about the harm of diet culture and how to fight back. So you can find more information about Olaiya's series at the link in the chat, which I am going to drop in now, actually, because I'm realizing I have to talk and do links at the same time. I gotta multitask. Here we go. There you go. So as I mentioned, we are interested in hearing from you. So I'm going to, at the close of the event, I'll post a link to a program survey in the chat. And I would really appreciate it if you took a minute, clicked on it, and took a minute to let us know what you think. I'm so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you so much, Meghna, and our partners at Book Larder. And thanks to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, the Seattle Public Library. Of course, thank you to all of our amazing panelists tonight and to Olaiya for curating this. And of course, thanks to all of you who joined us digitally to be here tonight. Thanks so much for being here, and we will see you next time. Good night, everybody.